بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد First of all, جزاكم الله خير to Brother Yusha Evans. I want to just take this opportunity and talk about something from the Quran, some ayat from the Quran. You know, subhanAllah, in these 10 days, there are some basic things we have been talking about. We have been talking about the dhikr of Allah. We've been talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam. We've been talking about the day of Eid. We have been talking about how blessed these days are. We have been talking about Hajj. We have been talking about Ayyamut Tashriq. We have been talking about Takbiratul Tashriq, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and so forth. We have been talking about the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And what's interesting is that all these topics that we talk about in our khutbas and so forth, is that all these topics, subhanAllah, have been compiled into one surah, one beautiful surah in the 17th juz. And it is only fitting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the ulama who came later on, in fact, they mention and they name the surah, Suratul Hajj. Suratul Hajj. There's only one surah of the Quran that has been named after a pillar of Islam. There is no surah called Suratul Shahada. There is no surah called Suratul Salat or Suratul Siyam or Suratul Zakat. But there is something called Suratul Hajj. Alama As-Suyuti Rahmatullahi Alayhi, he has written a very beautiful book called Al-Itqan Fi Ulum Al-Quran. It is one of the premier traditional classical books on Ulum Al-Quran, the sciences of the Quran. In fact, all the current day books that we find on the subject of sciences of the Quran, they all go and they refer to this book written by Alama As-Suyuti Rahmatullahi Alayhi, a very famous classical scholar. In his book, he actually talks about the themes of each surah. And when he gets to Surah Al-Hajj, he says that one of the beautiful things about Surah Al-Hajj is that there are ayat. This is a compilation of so many different things. In this surah, Allah mentions some Makki ayat. In the same surah, Allah mentions some Madani ayat. There are some ayat in this surah that were revealed when the Prophet ﷺ was traveling. And there are some ayat that are revealed in the surah when the Prophet ﷺ was at home. There are some ayat that were revealed in difficult circumstances. And there are some ayat that are revealed in this surah that are related to ahkam. And what he mentions is that this is just a nutshell of so many different things that we find in our deen. To begin with, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many times He has talked about Jannah? How many times He has talked about Jahannam? How many times He has talked about the Day of Judgment? But for you and I, for the most part, when we see something, we understand something. But when we don't see something, and we have never witnessed something, then something becomes abstract. We know something is there, but I have still no idea what Allah is talking about. Allah is telling us that if you want to get an idea of what possibly the Day of Judgment looks like, where people are in the state of chaos, people have no idea what's going on, then the best thing to do is to look at the state of Hajj. Look at Hajj, because what do we see in Hajj? We see a huge group of people that they are wearing, especially for the men, for the women, the restrictions of Umrah or the rules of Umrah are more flexible for the women than they are for the men. But if you were to line up a huge group of men, you cannot tell the difference between their socioeconomic status. You cannot tell the difference between who is rich and who is poor, because everyone is in one state. And that in itself, Allah is telling us that that is what the Day of Judgment will look like. On the Day of Judgment, no one's going to be able to differentiate between who has more wealth and who has less wealth. Who has a greater status in the community or who has a lesser status in the community. Everyone is going to be alike. And the fact that the people, when they go for Hajj and they are underneath the sun, they are going through Mina and they're going through Arafah and Muzdalifah, and in Muzdalifah they're sleeping beneath the stars. This is going to be like the Day of Judgment. The sun is going to be so close. Unfortunately, today we see what is going on with Hajj. Hajj has become, you know, there are some packages for Hajj that are extremely extremely easy. In fact, I'm not going to go into some names of Hajj groups, but I found out that there are some Hajj groups that, subhanAllah, fresh sushi is being cut. You know, oysters are being cracked open, lobsters are being cooked inside the tents, and there's like a buffet going on. In fact, some people even told me that it's even a vacation at times. In fact, there was a brother who told me that one time in their own tent, they were cooking a lamb. And people from the other tent came to their tent and said that, mashallah, this lamb is very beautiful, it seems very delicious. The smell is coming all the way to our tent. And the brother said that, brother, what can I say? You only paid for the smell, I paid for the food. Okay? But that's the situation of Hajj, unfortunately. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to tell us that when you are in Hajj, what Hajj was long time ago, that gives you a glimpse of what the Day of Judgment is like. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَوْمَ تَرَوْنَهَا, that on that day, تَذْهَلُ كُلُّ مُرْضِعَةٍ عَمَّا أَرْضَعَتْ وَتَضَعُ كُلُّ ذَاتِ حَمْلٍ حَمْلَهَا, that every mother who is feeding her child, she would forget her child. And it's not as if that will be happening on the Day of Judgment, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to paint a scene for us. That imagine if you were to see a mother feeding her child in this dunya, do you really believe that she would just forget about her child? Absolutely not. If you see a person who's intoxicated, you know from far he's intoxicated. And what do we say? Stay away from those kind of people. But on the Day of Judgment, the way people will be running around for one good deed, they will be going to their mother and their father. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ. They're in the state, يُغْنِي. On that day, a man, a father will run away from his son. Sons, children will run away from their siblings. Children run away from their parents in this dunya as it is. Okay, so I know that. But even in the akhirah, the children are going to be running away from their parents. Wife will run away from their husband. It happens, I know, in this dunya too. Okay? Husbands will run away from their wife. It happens in this dunya too. But it happens on that day because they just want one good deed. That's all they want. It's like, imagine your child coming to you for a dollar. Can I have a dollar? And you're like, of course. Here's a dollar. And if you're more generous, here's $5. Go help yourself. But on the Day of Judgment, you're not willing to give even one good deed. That is the state of our affair that will take place on the Day of Judgment. And for the most part. So in this surah, there is so much of that mentioned. Now, without going into a lot of details, because there is so much mentioned in this surah, there are a few important things I do want to cover. First of all, is that in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He talks about the most important thing that you and I would need to develop in our life is taqwa. Taqwa. When you have taqwa, you have the cautiousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu rabbakum. And here Allah is addressing mankind. Ittaqu rabbakum. Inna zalzalatas sa'ati shay'un 'azim. This tremor that will take place on the Day of Judgment is very severe. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He goes into stories after stories, ayat into ayat. And the first thing I do want to mention is this. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned four different types of hearts. The first heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about is the heart of those people who are sick. The heart that is sick. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. In whose heart there is sickness, Allah only increases that sickness. Now, let me give you an example. Have you ever seen, you know, in this day and age, we see like within the American culture that we live in, it doesn't happen hopefully in our Muslim families, but in the American culture, there is a practice in many families where people have a stack of magazines in their bathroom. You know that, right? They have a stack of magazines in their bathroom. Long time ago, they used to have, nowadays the magazines are gone, now you have digital magazines, okay? And now you have phones, and people are sitting on the toilets and they're playing with their phone, even inside the bathroom. May Allah forgive us all. But that's what's happening today. Long time ago, it was not a practice. People thought that it was really weird. It was really weird. Why would you take magazines and put them inside the bathroom? But what happens is this, something we don't know about the heart is this. When your heart becomes used to something, that you don't feel like it's wrong anymore. In fact, you feel like it's absolutely fine. I'll give you another example. The LGBT issues that you and I, we all hear about. Long time ago, when we talked about LGBT, it was considered as a taboo subject. We knew, of course, our deen teaches us what it teaches us. But even in society, society would see that as something that is wrong. I mean, someone, a man who came out of the closet, as they say, a man who came out of the closet was considered as something big. But nowadays, there is no big deal if someone comes out in the media and the society that says that this is how I, these are my preferences. This is my way of life. What has happened over time is that something that is a disease, something that is a sickness, I would say, more than disease, is a sickness. It became normalized. When wrong things become normalized in our life, في قلوبهم مرض. You have a sickness in your heart. But what happens is that sickness only grows. The second type of heart that Allah mentions in surah is a heart that becomes hard. When a person's heart becomes sick and the wrong things become normal in our life, a person is about to commit a sin. They think 10 times. They commit the sin. And now they keep on committing that sin. That means that your heart has become sick. Then after a while, what happens is the ayat of the Quran are recited. The ahadith are recited. You hear khutbah after khutbah. But then what happens is it just bounces off your heart. That at that time, your heart becomes hard. في قلوبهم Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He refers to that heart as وَالْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ. This is in Surah Al-Hajj. وَالْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ. The third type of heart, the heart that becomes blind. You know, a hard heart, at the end of the day, you can probably break it, you can probably crack it. But at the end, but one thing is that when you have a blind heart, a heart that cannot see, a blind person has no idea, has no clue where they're going. They have no idea what they're doing is right or wrong. If there is a snake in front of them, a person who can see can tell that there's a snake and they'll back away. A blind person does not know. A person whose heart has become blind, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَى الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. This is Surah Al-Hajj also. The hearts have become blind. When you do not even realize anymore what you're doing is wrong, when you have no focus of life, as Brother Yusha was talking about, when you have no priority of life, that means that your heart is blind. It cannot see anymore. It does not have the ability to absorb the Quran, to absorb the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is, all of it in itself is a gradual process. Shaitan does not take us to the point where our hearts become blind. But first of all, he makes those things that are unacceptable in our life, he makes them acceptable. Then after that, our hearts become hard. And then after that, he takes us to the point where our hearts become completely blind. That even when we talk to people, have you talked to people when you hear them talk, they use ayat of the Quran, they think that they are religious, but you talk to them and you're like, my God, like I have no idea. Like, how do you understand this? Why can you not understand a simple concept of our deen? They call themselves Muslims. That is the state when their hearts become completely blind. The fourth kind of heart is a heart, a different kind of heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He refers to this heart as, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ, that these are the people whose hearts are devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanAllah, in the following ayah, what does He say? الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ, when the ayat are recited, وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, they feel something in their heart. They feel like that, you know what, my heart has been affected. If we feel that our heart is being affected, when you and I, when we do something wrong, and there is some guilt in my heart, or there might not be guilt at that time, but later on there is guilt in my heart, that means that there is still remnants of some nur of iman in my heart. وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ, Allah says, give glad tidings to those people who have that kind of heart, because when they hear the ayat of Allah, there is some iman left in their heart that when they hear, hopefully inshallah, they will come back and they will repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, with all this being said, I want to take you to the end of this surah. Once again, this whole surah is talking about developing that taqwa, the fear of the Akhirah, making sure that we are prepared for the Akhirah. But the last part, first of all, this last passage starts off with something very beautiful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that you and I, we have this nature that a lot of times we don't focus on the message, we focus on the messenger. Imagine the entire masjid is full. Is Jummah khutbah going on? Or let's just say Eid Salat is going on. And the person is not able to come all the way inside the masjid. Just give you a very typical example. A person is sitting all the way outside the masjid or in the lobby area. They're not able, they don't have a TV there. They cannot see who the khatib is. And they hear the khutbah and they're like, man, that is an amazing khutbah. That is an amazing khutbah. And let's just say the guy who gave the khutbah, okay, let's just say the guy who gave the khutbah does not necessarily look like, or he has the attire or the looking of a typical learned scholar or sheikh, okay? And he comes outside, or there, let's just say, you know, it could be anyone. And he comes outside and someone, and he says, man, do you know who gave today's khutbah? That was an amazing khutbah. And they're like, you know, you see that guy over there? He gave the khutbah. They're like, nah, it can't be. That guy, he can talk like that? That's what happens. We don't look at the message. A lot of times we focus on the messenger. You know, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Allah gives an example. You know, when Allah says Allah gives an example, the Quraysh will say, oh, Allah is giving. You know, like when children, when they want to really annoy their parents, la 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 la. You know, when they put their fingers in their ears and they just completely make absurd sounds because they don't want to hear their parents talk. The Quraysh, they will put their fingers inside their ears and they're like, Allah is talking, I don't want to hear it. I'm done. I don't want to hear Allah talk. This is what they would say. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. An example has been given to you, listen attentively. Oh, okay, so there's no mention of Allah here in this ayah. Okay, let me listen to this example. Because a lot of times, what we do is that we focus, as I said, we focus on the messenger, not on the message. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to get a message across. And what's the first thing that He said? He says, Ya أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تدعون من دون الله لن يخلقوا ذبابا ولا اجتمعوا له. You and what you believe in, this thing that you do shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you worship other deities, you think that they are so powerful, but if they were to all come together and they were to try to create the smallest thing on earth, such as a mosquito, لن يخلقوا ذبابا, they will not be able to create this. They will not be able to do this. Why am I telling you this? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trying to tell them? It's because Allah, at the end of the day, He has all the power. Now, after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the last two ayat, I'm going to finish on this inshallah. Two beautiful ayat. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He starts off by talking to everyone who has faith in their heart. Not only to those people who are in Hajj, but to the entire Muslim ummah. He says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, irka'u. Make ruku'a. Wasjudu Rabbakum, and make sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wafa'alu al-khayra, that do good. Engage in things that are good. La'allakum tuflihun, so you can be successful. Okay? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Now, what does this word la'allakum tuflihun actually mean? It means that when you see, because the word tuflihun comes from the word falah, and a farmer is called a falah. What that means is that when a farmer puts the seed into the ground, it takes an enormous amount of effort to see that seed grow. You just don't put the seed in the ground and you see it grow tomorrow. It doesn't work like that. You have to come, you have to look after it, you got to put a big scarecrow outside to ensure that all the animals stay away. You keep on coming, you keep on looking at it, you keep on watering it at the right times, and after a while, you see all this sprout. You see all this sprout. It takes hard work. It takes hard work. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next ayah, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِ. وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِ. Now, this jahidu does not mean that go into jihad. What this means is that strive Because Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi, he has written a very famous book on the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's called Zadul Ma'ad fi Hadi Khayl Ibad. In this book he has written, under the subject of jihad, he has written that there are 16 to 17 different types of jihad. The fact that you and I have to wake up from Salatul Fajr, when it's so difficult, that in itself is a jihad. The fact that we stay away from haram, in itself is a jihad. Every good that we do, and we have to give up something, or we have to make a sacrifice, is a kind of jihad. Amr bil ma'roof and nahi an munkar is a jihad. He has mentioned 16 to 17 different types of jihad. What this here ayah means is that strive, and the literal meaning of this ayah is strive in Allah. What does that mean? It doesn't make any sense. If a person says, or if Allah said, strive in the cause of Allah, or strive for Allah, it makes complete sense. But strive in Allah, it means strive in keeping your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's going to take a lot of difficulty on your part. Fitnas are going to come your way. Challenges are going to come your way. And you're going to be deviated. You're going to be pushed in the wrong direction. But the fact that you remain steadfast and you remain on this path of Allah and maintain this relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, جَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِ. Give it in a way, a strive in maintain this relationship with Allah the way it is to be maintained. Meaning that do everything in your power that what you need to do. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, huwajtabakum. He has chosen you. He has chosen all of us. Huwajtabakum. Wama ja'ala alaykum fid din min haraj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not put any kind of haraj in our deen. Today we say deen is too difficult. It's not that deen is too difficult. Today there are fitnas that are taking place. Today there are fitnas taking place. And when these fitnas take place, it becomes our responsibility to be on board. Yes, as a Muslim, if these challenges are coming, I'm still a Muslim. In the same surah, in Surah Al-Hajj, Allah actually talks about a group of people. He says that who are the ultimate losers? Ultimate losers, because in that ayah he says khusranul mubin. You know, in the ayah there are few words that Allah uses for the word loss. He uses the word khusr. Wal asr innal insana lafi khusr. It is a type of loss. Any kind of loss is the word khusr. Then Allah uses the word khasara, is another higher level of loss. The word khusran is the highest level of loss that you can be. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ, there are some people, مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ حَرْفٍ. They are worshipping Allah right on the edge. Right on the edge. Meaning what? That, فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٍ اِطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ. If there is anything good that comes our way, oh man, I'm a Muslim. Allah is my Rabb. I'm a believer in the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I got this, I got that. He is so happy. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ. But when the fitnas come, when the trials come, when there is something that happens in society and it becomes difficult for a Muslim man, and especially for our Muslim sisters, to go out in hijab because they are scared that someone is going to physically harm them. When the fitnas come, انقلب على وجهه. These people, they turn away. Nah, you know what? I'm okay with not being a Muslim. These people can do whatever they want to do. I'm not a Muslim. Now, think about this. Imagine you are on a ship. Okay? Imagine you are on this big, huge ship. Imagine this ship is your Islam. The ocean is kufr. Now you see that, you know what? The ship is going up and down and up and down, and you feel like, you know what? I'm done with. Let me just jump ship right now. Let me get my life jacket. I'm going to swim. I'm a great swimmer. I'll just swim away and I'll get away somewhere else. You jumped off. Okay? You jumped off and you went straight into kufr. And it doesn't mean that now because you land in kufr, everything's going to be fine. You lost. You're losing in the fact, you are a loser in the fact that you jumped into kufr. And let's just say you stay on board. You stayed on board. And in that case, you know, you at that time, you give up your Islam. You're like, you know what? I don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anymore. You know, I don't want to do this anymore. You start calling out to other people and other deities besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no, so neither do you have your dunya nor your akhirah. Now, when we see people in this dunya today who don't have any dunya and they don't have an akhirah either, they don't believe in Allah, what do we call those people? What do we call these people? Losers, right? Yes or no? We say, right, like there are people who have so much wealth, and they say, and we say what? That, you know what, at least Allah gave them dunya. But when a person doesn't have dunya, a person doesn't have akhirah, and not only that, but they don't even believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say, ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. This is what the Qur'an says. Because when a person, he gives up his deen, when a person gives up his deen just for, because of the smallest things, or even when he says, you know what, I don't need Islam, then this is when a person, he loses. You don't get your dunya, you don't get your akhirah. At least a person who stays on Islam, let's just say a person stayed on that ship and he died on that ship, at least he'll be resurrected. At least he'll be resurrected amongst the Muslims. But that did not happen either. ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. In our life, trials are going to come our way. Allah is going to send trials our way, but we have to remain steadfast. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why He says, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ هُوَجْتَبَاكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. Then He says, مِلَّةَ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. Once again, as I said earlier, this surah, it encompasses every single thing that you can possibly imagine that we have talked about in the subject of Dhul-Hijjah. He says, مِلَّةَ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. This is the millah of your forefather Ibrahim alayhi salam. Who was سماكم المسلمين, and he named you a Muslim before, من قبل وفي هذا. Right now you are a Muslim, even before that you were a Muslim too, because a Muslim is one who submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. من قبل وفي هذا ليكون الرسول شهيدا عليكم وتكونوا شهداء على الناس. So you can be a witness against people on the day of judgment. When Isa alayhi salam will come on the day of judgment, and the people will say that we believe in Isa alayhi salam, we worship Isa alayhi salam, and Isa alayhi salam says, man, I have nothing to do with you, man. I have no idea who you are on the day of judgment. And all these prophets will come, and their people would have neglected them. On the day of judgment, the ummah of Rasulullah will say that we are witnesses that of the fact that these people did not even come to us. We did not even follow the Sharia, but the fact that we believed in them. We knew them. We followed their teachings. We read their stories in the Quran. We learned from their stories. And you, on the other hand, you do not even believe in them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Establish your prayer. وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ. And give your zakat. وَعَتَصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ. And hold on to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because once again, this dunya is going to take you on a roller coaster. No, life is not going to be easy. وَعَتَصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ هُوَ مَوْلَاكُمْ. He is our Mawla. He is your Mawla. And you know, as I mentioned one time at the end of the Surah Al-Baqarah Tafsir, that this Mawla means He is your protector. He is the one who's going to look after you. And then He says, Ni'ma al-Mawla. And there is no one who is a better Mawla than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ni'ma al-Mawla wa ni'ma al-Nasir. He is the greatest helper you can possibly imagine. So when we need help, we go to Allah. When we need protection, we go to Allah. When I need confidence in my deen, I go to Allah. When I need to set up priorities in my life, I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I need to solve my problems, I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I need things in my life, I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what the word Mawla actually means. That He is the one that I resort to in every single thing. So this surah in itself, as I said, that first of all, this surah begins off by talking about the day of judgment. Because Hajj, what it's supposed to be like, and the day of judgment has a lot of similarities. We then talked about the four types of heart. What's the first heart? The sick heart. The second heart? The heart, when it becomes a hard heart. The third heart? The blind heart. The fourth heart? The one that is devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, we strive and we will strive to maintain this relationship. And I will say this, last thing I'll say this. Allah mentioned, work hard to maintain this relationship. Right before that in the ayah, He says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Meaning what? That in order for you to maintain your relationship is going to be very difficult. You're not going to get it overnight. You might pray salat, and you might feel the next day you again commit haram, and you feel like, you know what, what's the point of this relationship? I come to Allah and Allah does not care. It doesn't work like that. It takes time to build a relationship. You know when someone's really upset with you, and the first thing that you do, you want to maintain a relationship with them, you will go to them and make salam first. The next day you'll say, how are you doing? The next day you'll increase that conversation. And slowly and gradually you build a relationship with someone. When it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it takes time. It takes a lot of diligence. It takes a lot of hard work to build up that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet, you think that he got that relationship overnight? No. He worked on it. He would wake up at night, pray to Allah, be connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they were able to build a connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give all of us ability to act what has been said and heard. Once again, this surah, Surah Al-Hajj, please, if you get a chance, do go through it. And once again, every single thing that is mentioned here in the Quran, and there's so many things that I could have shared, but because of time I cannot, but try to go through the surah inshallah on your own free time. Go through all the parallels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions very beautiful examples in the surah, and Allah covers a variety of things in the surah inshallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give all of us ability to act what has been said and heard. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah, one last thing is, I read an ayah from Surah Al-Hajj that has a sajda at the end of it. So I'm sorry to give you the bad news. You have to all make a sajda after this, okay? So make a sajda whenever you can, inshallah. Now, after this, there is some snacks and refreshments for both brothers and sisters, inshallah. Brothers can go in the multipurpose hall on their side. Sisters can go in the multipurpose hall on their side, inshallah. In the next probably 10, 15 minutes, inshallah, we'll give 10, 15 minutes. After that, we will start qiyam, inshallah. Hafiz Sajjad will be here. He will do qiyam for another like 25 minutes, inshallah, followed by witr. And then after the witr, inshallah, you all can go home. Make the niyyah of fasting, inshallah. Wake up for suhoor, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.